we're very lucky right now to have Ronny, Thomale, and what's the title of your talk? Oh, direct electrons on the sphere. And so we're going to actually learn how to do some calculations here. All right, let's welcome Ronny.
Okay, first of all, let me thank Eric and Mona for inviting me here to give the lecture and actually reviewing what we've been listening to today and the day before. I think, I have to appreciate the difference between talks and lectures a bit more, because I feel like the lecture, at least as how I would perceive it when I teach in Würzburg, would be more concentrating on sort of a smaller subset of field or a smaller electronic problem that we want to discuss, but then we should rather go into detail and in a way that you can follow, in a way that you can concisely and vigorously follow the calculations and also might accomplish some insight into intermediate steps that you could do on your own after the lecture. So the lecture will be composed as follows. I will start fairly elementary, in a fairly elementary fashion, and the degree of complexity will increase as we move along. I will always make a C sign for check, in case in retrospective, when you go through the notes of the lecture, you can actually try to calculate from the last line before the check sign to the next line after the check sign. And the topic that we'll discuss, as it was also said by Una and Eric, is supposed to be a topic that is tractable at the time scale of 90 minutes that I have, and at the same time should link to actually interesting research of today. And I think we can get there if we keep going. So the topic is Dirac fermions on the sphere. Well, let me leave the second part of the title aside for the moment. Dirac electrons are ubiquitous in contemporary physics, in particular in condensed matter. We all know surface states of topological insulators, graphene, boundary states of topological phases to a topologically trivial phase. So actually, Dirac fermions, in one way or the other, have nearly appeared in any talk that you've seen so far. So we want to particularize to the problem of Dirac fermions at a rigorous level. And in the end of the day, what these two lectures are supposed to give you is a first quantized exact description of the Dirac cone as the boundary theory of a three-dimensional topological insulator. That's the ultimate goal, and from there, actually, a lot of research topics would unfold themselves that you could actually pursue starting from these lectures. On our way there, we'll actually pass some other traditional problems. And let me come to the structure of the lecture. So we'll start with, maybe let me first give you the main literature for the two lectures. So for today, we'll start with a paper by Frederick Duncan Michael Haldane. PRL 51605-1983. This is what we'll study in detail. As we move on, I will cross over to recent work of ours in the context of 3D topological insulators, but an initial good reference as well is by Imura, Yoshimura, Kana Fukui, which is a PRB. 86235119 from 2012. Is this big enough for you to read also in the back row? Is that okay?
And those in the back, they can always move forward.
Then there's a paper by us. That's notepad at all, PRL 115017001, 2015. And then there's another one. Structure will be as follows. Well, that doesn't help you much, but after the lecture, you won't have to read that paper anymore. I'll tell you. So I divide the lectures in two main problems. We talk about massive fermions or massive electrons. I will only talk about electrons here. Massive electrons and in that case of massive electrons, I will talk about two subtopics, lambda levels in plane. I will talk about another topic, lambda levels on the sphere, and then I will have the second topic, Dirac fermions, Dirac electrons, and I'll talk about lambda levels in plane, and then guess what, I will talk about, a different order of describing it. I will be talking about the 3D CI surface, and that will be sort of described by the sort of headline Variflux monopole. And then finally, which is the main statement I want to convey, universality one coupled Dirac fermions on the sphere. So in many ways it's basically an extended homework solution of what Santo told you, is supposed to figure out what the solution of electrons on the of Dirac electrons on the sphere is. But on our way there to that goal, I think we can learn a lot of interesting things by first starting with massive electrons and understanding about the structure of lambda levels. And let's start very elementary and start with Oh, there's a lot of casualties from there. 1.1. So let's talk about spin polarized electrons in the XY plane, subject to magnetic fields.
Yeah.
So,
and we just the complex coordinates will be very helpful for us. So let's first define the complex derivatives in our way that is convenient for our purpose here. Y elements bar.
That the Hermitian conjugate is minus partial v bar. You get one minus sign on the I, but then you have the overall minus sign due to the Hermitian conjugate. So with this, let me also still define complex momentum. Minus 2i h bar partial z bar, and p bar is px minus I dy is minus 2i h bar partial z. Now, what are we talking about here? The single particle Hamiltonian is just a kinetic Hamiltonian of an electron subject to that field. So it is just the free Hamiltonian with a dynamical momentum replaced by the canonical momentum. So it is h is 1 over 2m p plus e over ca squared, e larger than 0, m larger than 0, and fixing a symmetric h. And defining the magnetic length to be a h bar c over eb, we end up getting h is, just plugging this in is 1 over, I give you one intermediate step because I promised you to start elementary, dx plus h bar over 2l squared y squared plus py minus h bar over 2l squared x squared is equal to one over 2m real part squared of p minus I h bar 2n squared z plus imaginary part squared of p minus I h bar over 2l squared z. And then we can easily find that this is h squared over 2n l squared of a new operator a bar, where a and a bar I define as follows. I'll just put it here because I will have a more convenient form of a for later purposes. But for the moment, let me just spell it out for you that you have the calculation there. That's 1 over 2l squared z, and a dagger is l over square root of 2 minus 2 partial z plus 1 over 2l squared z bar. And then you can convince yourself that a dagger has bosonic commutation relations.
And the curly bracket for anti-commutator?
Oh, that's just the anti-commutator. Okay, so is that clear? So who has not solved the lambda level problem by himself ever? I think everyone did, Alex. except for some books. And the reason why I'm showing you this fairly elementary exercise is that what we will need later on is this notion of these ladder operators. And in many solutions of the number level problem, people don't bother introducing these ladder operators, but they will be vital to simplifying our understanding of any lambda level formation for any dispersion relation that you can think of. This is why I wanted to go through this quite quickly with you. And then let us think a little bit more about then how this Hamiltonian looks. This, so we just, with the commutation relations, this just becomes h bar omega c of a dagger a plus 1/2. And omega c is the cyclotron frequency. Did I use capital M? Yeah. Is the cyclotron frequency, and you can see that the kinetic energy of charged particles in a perpendicular magnetic field are quantized like a harmonic oscillator. Okay.
I have a question.
Yes.
So the other thing that when one does the Landau problem is when there was this big degeneracy.
Yeah, let me
so
come
how
to that.
I know the degeneracy?
Yeah, let me come to
we're
that in the next 2 minutes. So, okay, and now I realize what Michael told me. I mean, it's a little bit counterintuitive now, but okay, using
you
these forces in this order, but
yes.
Okay.
Slide that one all the way up and then the other one.
Yeah, yeah, but okay. Yeah.
There's also electronic wave movement at that time.
Okay. So, yeah. Now, what's the starting point for us now? The starting point for us is exactly what Eric was bringing up. How do we further understand now the specific degeneracy of the individual levels that we found in the lambda level problem? So for that purpose, let me introduce ladder operators in the following way. So let me first say that we introduce two sets of ladder operators. The first one is this AA dagger that you've seen before, but I will rewrite it in a slightly modified fashion, and you could easily get this by just commuting through the derivative operator. So A, as I define it now, is square root of 2L e to the minus 1 over 4L z bar z partial z bar e to the 1 over 4L, oh, there's a square, sorry, 4L squared z bar z. And a dagger is just, I hope you can understand what I'm doing here now. So this is just a plus instead of a minus. This is a minus, and this is partial z. Is that short notation clear? Then I introduce a second set of ladder operators. So these ladder operators are called cyclotron variables. So the next set of ladder operators is square root of 2L e to the minus 1 over 4L squared z z bar partial z e to the 1 over 4L squared z bar z. So there's a minus, there's no bar, there's a plus. And now I have the B dagger. I'm sorry, here's a minus sign here. Sorry for that. So there's the B dagger, and the B dagger obeys minus square root of 2L. Now there's a plus here, there's a partial z bar here, and there's a minus here. And these two are called guiding center variables. Now what is this good for? You'll see that in a second. Let me just finish this board by saying that both of them are bosonic operators, bosonic ladder operators, and that they commute with each other. So, And these guiding center variables, reflecting on what Eric has brought up, allow us to label the degeneracy of the individual cyclotron levels. And you can see that from the following thing. If you now, and now you, it's the first time that you see a check sign, so this is what you're supposed to calculate on your own. So as you see, like, this is the level that you give lectures in Germany, like very concise and everyone is supposed to follow. So that's what students expect from you there. So check that the angular momentum R cross P is just H bar of B dagger B minus A dagger A. This angular momentum is, and that is important to notice, the canonical angular momentum. You say kinematical or? So this is an important thing. So you notice that the energy of the electron subject to the magnetic field only depend on the eigenvalue that they have with respect to the A dagger A operator, basically just which cyclotron eigenvalue that they have, or stated differently, which lambda level then. But within the lambda level, the canonical angular momentum can vary a lot. And still, the energy, the kinetic energy, doesn't care about this angular momentum. And in particular, notice one thing, and when the lowest lambda level, you shouldn't think about angular momentum anymore. This angular momentum ladder operator here is a purely comes along due to its canonical nature and doesn't link to kinematic angular momentum. So in the lowest lambda level, the electrons are frozen, period. There's no such thing like angular momentum left. That's a thing, I'm stressing that because if you listen to people in the field even, sometimes that confusion carries over to more complicated problems where it's indispensable to distinguish canonical and kinematical angular momentum. What this, of course, still helps us with, this canonical angular momentum, is that we can now classify the degenerate states in one lambda level, obviously. So we use L to classify the extensively degenerate states in the lambda level. So that is, we have a lambda level index n, we have a guiding center index n. So for a given lambda level, this guiding index level n can run through the lambda level and label the individual states of that lambda level. And this is just already in an orthonormal base, written in an orthonormal basis. This is just one over n factorial, the square root of this times 1 over factorial of m times the ladder operators that you would know from quantum mechanics in many different contexts. And then finally, let's also work out most of the stuff can be done algebraically. There's only one single thing step, one last step need to be done analytically, namely fixing the vacuum state that I defined. The vacuum state is defined to be annihilated by the ladder operators. So this is a very simple differential equation. And this differential equation you can solve, and you would know it probably already from previous studies. And so the R projection of that vacuum is 1 over square root 2 pi L squared e to the minus 4 L squared, absolute value of z squared. If you want, you can also check that this is the solution.
Is B the complex conjugate of A?
Sorry?
No.
Is B the complex conjugate of A?
Let me see. No. Because under Hermitian conjugate, you mean the complex conjugate or Hermitian conjugate?
Not Hermitian complex.
Probably.
Yeah,
that's right, but it has not much meaning. But it's not the Hermitian conjugate. So that's the important thing. Yeah?
So in the net field, the electrons are going around in circles. So how can there not be any electrons?
This is the pure classical picture. This is not in quantum mechanics, this is not true. The lowest lambda level, everything is frozen. You might have an edge mode, and we can talk about that for open boundaries. Here, in the way I'm setting this up in this droplet geometry, I'm not caring about this one edge mode that indeed, you know, has a dispersion relation and this and that. I want to stress that in the quantum nature of the lambda level is enormous. There is no angular momentum left. All the electrons are frozen in the lambda level. And the only thing that you get is canonical angular momentum, but not kinematic angular momentum. That's an absolutely essential thing to appreciate. But thanks, this is really at the heart of the problem. A lot of semi-classical pictures apply to the edge mode. You go with a skipping orbit and it moves along and so on. But it does not apply to the bulk nature of the state that actually characterized the insulator. And you can just see, I mean, there's no kinematic angular momentum left, just canonical. But we'll see this more clearly as we go to the sphere.
And I don't think I agree, but I don't want to have an argument right now.
Okay. Well, okay, I could simply say the B ladder operators do not enter in the Hamiltonian, but they enter in characterizing the angular momentum. That's the rigorous statement that I'm making.
So the very simple physical thing you could do is, which actually is very, very apropos in cold atoms, that you add a harmonic oscillator to this, or they also, quantum dot people do this, get a harmonic oscillator potential to this problem. And then the B operator starts moving you around in this space. You can see that it takes you to states that are moving in circles that are largely collapsed.
Yeah, but since they are degenerate, you'll
so
just
not when you put a harmonic oscillator on.
Right, but you, yes, but okay. So we can elaborate on this later on. The main thing is that was also brought up by people in the audience. The main thing to appreciate is that in the lowest lambda level, the electrons are substantially frozen to the extent that you should not think anymore of any semi-classical picture of electrons moving around in small circles given by the magnetic line. This is not the appropriate way of thinking about it. At least I would say so.
I can make a wave packet that is lowest lambda level.
Maybe as we go to the sphere, I can make my point clearer and we can come back to that question. Convert ladder operators into particle coordinates. So that's simple. So the complex particle coordinate Z is just A plus B dagger, and P is minus I h bar over square root times L A minus B dagger. And then, this is the same thing that you always do with harmonic oscillators. You're trying to solve as much as you can algebraically. You finish the analytic solution of the vacuum. So what you do, you can get all the excited states just by acting with the ladder operators on the solved vacuum state. And this is what we're doing here. And you obtain the complete orthonormal set of basis states. For that case, let me particularize to the lowest lambda level. phi n of z is the real space projection on 0 n, and this is 1 over m factorial b dagger to the power of m acting on the ground state that we've written down, before, and that gives you 1 over square root 2 to the m plus 1 pi m factorial l to the n plus 1. That's all irrelevant, it's just a prefactor. Then the most important thing is the z to the n. Now, let me just finish by saying, how should we interpret these states that I just spanned? And maybe for that, yeah, let me just try to write it down here. So, phi n of z describe narrow rings, centered around the origin. With a radius that we can just obtain by looking whether dominantly populated as a function of R. So we request that the partial derivative of R of the absolute value of that wave function as a function of R at the Rm be zero, and what you find is that this particular peak of the occupation probability is Rn is square root of 2m times L, and the aerial degeneracy is just the number of states divided by the area. So this is 1 over 2 pi L squared. And if you then ask, what is the magnetic flux through such a course by such a thing, then it would be 2 pi L squared times the magnetic field, which is exactly 2 pi H bar C over E, and that is the Dirac flux quantum. Now let me come back to what Eric has said. And maybe it's a misunderstanding of language, but let me restate what I wanted to express. If I go through these different states and I change this m variable, would you think that the kinematic angular momentum changes or not? They're bigger rings, right? So maybe the angular momentum is bigger. No, it's not true. They all have the same kinematic angular momentum. It is just a way of labeling the density of states in the lambda level. The kinematic angular momentum is the same for all these individual states. And the fact that we can label them by some canonical angular momentum is good for us, but we should not be sort of misunderstood by interpreting the nature of these states. They all have the same kinematic angular momentum.
But it's non-zero.
Sorry?
But it's non-zero.
Well, there's the zero-point motion, but aside from that, in the lowest number level, it is zero. I mean, A dagger A is zero. So the kinematic angular momentum part that comes, that enters L, is zero, because A dagger A is zero. Any lowest number level state is annihilated by the ladder operator A.
Maybe I missed it, but I think my confusion is, right, what is the relationship between the kinematic angular momentum and A?
Oh yeah, so
did you say
it's basically, no, I didn't say that. It is basically, so it's hard to tear them apart, but it's clear to identify that whatever kinematic angular momentum there is, it is related to A. And whatever additional non-kinematical contribution adds to it is related to B. And you can see it here. I mean, it's very clear. All of these states have the same energy. Imagine, you increase the angular momentum. Should the energy be invariant on how much angular momentum, kinematic angular momentum, you have? Of course not. If the interpretation were right that these individual states had different angular momentum, the energies would have to be different. That's obvious. Okay. So, but you can see it's a fairly trivial problem, and we already have quite some discussions about the interpretation of the fairly trivial result. Okay, so let me finish this discussion by the way, how am I doing on time?
You can go, I think, until 3:40.
Okay. Okay, I have to speed up a little bit. So let me just finish with one little observation that you probably all know. So the most general form, of a lowest Landau level state, a single particle state, but I stop sort of being specific about this. I will only be talking about single particle states in this lecture, is a wave function of z. Is some f of z times e to the minus 1 over 4. I set the magnetic length to 1. We don't care about this anymore. Absolute value of z squared. And that, I think you know that the wave functions in the lowest Landau level are analytic. They only depend on z, but not on z bar. It's very trivial in the ladder operators, because they annihilate by a, and a contains a derivative with respect to z bar. That's the analyticity criterion right there. Okay, how can we get now eigenstates for higher lambda levels from this lowest lambda level? Elevate psi of z into the n plus, do this one right, st now or th? N plus first, n plus first Landau level. So what do we do is we take the nth Landau level wave function just by doing what? In the same way as we were applying ladder operators of guiding variables to go through the states within one Landau level, we go up the Landau level ladder by the a ladder operators. So you just apply a n times, and what you get is such a form. F of z. And this is exactly what you wanted to have. You're seeing that in the higher lambda levels, okay, can everyone read this? It's just inserting the expression of a dagger that I had before. This is an analytic function in z. But now that we acting with the ladder operators on it, the resulting function in the higher lambda levels both depends on z and z bar. So the analyticity criterion is lost as soon as we're in higher lambda levels. But I want to mention another aspect of it. If you recall, L was something like, no, I don't recall it myself anymore. Well, a dagger a minus b dagger b, right?
Yeah.
Or the other way around.
Other way around.
B dagger B minus, yeah, right. B dagger B minus A dagger A. So as we impose this ladder operator, the canonical angular momentum decreases by N. So what does that mean? That means that as we create the subspace of eigenstates in the lowest Landau level and intend to create the eigenstates of the first Lambda level, we get as much levels as in the lowest Lambda level plus one, because we have another angular momentum state. That's a finite size problem, like no experimentalist cares about it, but you'll see that details matter as we move on. So as you go for a finite size realization by saying I stabilize all states in the lowest Lambda level, and I want to create the states of the higher Lambda levels by acting on this lowest Lambda level manifold with the ladder operators, you'll find that the total number increases by one, because by this ladder operator formalism, if I go to the next Lambda level, the canonical angular momentum allows me to have one more state, because the A dagger A removes one canonical angular momentum from my expression. Okay?
But that's only true if you have an infinite system. We haven't talked about the boundaries on today. So the actual counting in a finite system,
yeah,
the argument doesn't necessarily work.
But you would find it for a disk. For a disk, you see it's exactly this. So this is true also for a finite size system, but there will be a funny subtlety on the sphere that people have not appreciated until 2011. But this is why I'm going with you through this. So the angular momentum decreases by n. So on the plane, that's the main result of this small detour, on the plane, the n plus 1 first Lambda level has n more states than the lowest Lambda level. Okay, so now we start with a sphere. So is this too slow for you? Is this too quick? Should I speed up a little bit? Okay. Let's repeat this problem. Now on a different manifold instead of a plane, let's look at the sphere. So this is 1.2. Lambda levels on sphere. So what we're dealing with, well, the sphere. And in the center, we place a magnetic monopole. And then if we place a magnetic monopole in the center of the sphere, the magnetic field will be radially pointing out of the sphere. So if you locally look on the surface on the sphere, this is exactly the compactified version of what we've been studying before. Okay? I'll come to subtleties later on, but let me first get the basic properties straight. So I want to look at a magnetic field that of strength H bar C, some parameter is not, that will be important later on, times R squared. R is the radius of the sphere, and the magnetic monopole in terms of Dirac flux quanta shall be, well, you can just put it in, R squared D over 2 pi H C over E is 2 as naught, and the number of Dirac quanta in the center of the sphere should be an integer due to Dirac quantization. So we know that 2 times as naught is element of natural numbers. Okay. So again, as before, what we want to look into is just the single particle Hamiltonian, the rotor Hamiltonian, on that sphere. So the Hamiltonian that we're talking about is H is some capital lambda over 2m r squared, which is cyclotron frequency over 2 as naught gamma squared, and then we define all the variables. Omega C is E times B over M, and the lambda operator is basically just the canonical angular momentum minus I plus EAR. R is R times dr. I'll define my spherical coordinates shortly. And the rotation of A is supposed to be the radial magnetic field. And I have set H bar equals C equal to 1. OK, so this is just definitions. And I need even more definitions. I need the definition of spherical coordinates the way I use them in the following. And I'll also give you a little bit of some lemmata that will help you to go through the calculation steps that follow. So let me first draw a sphere for the coordinates. I want to use coordinates in the following way. So if that is the y direction, and that is the x, and that is the z direction, I want to look at variables, one, how do you call them, the declinatory angle or something. So the theta angle that starts from the positive z-axis and bends down. And then I want to have the phi angle that starts from the positive y-axis and then evolves counterclockwise in the xy plane. And so let me just give you an idea as to how they look like. So for example, on the y-axis, the e theta is oriented like this, the e phi like that, and the er obviously along this. Maybe I should use a different color. Do I have that here?
No, it's
fine. It's fine. No, but you can see that. So this is just the right-handed coordinate system spanned by the spherical eigenvectors. Let me just write it down for you. Also, that makes life simpler. Cosine phi, sine theta, sine phi, sine theta, cosine theta. E theta as cosine phi cosine theta sine phi cosine theta minus sine theta. E phi is minus sine phi cosine phi 0. Yeah, I know it's a little bit boring, but we have to go through this because later on it will be much simpler for you to review your calculations. And then sometimes it's helpful to know in which order they form a right-handed system. And there's very different notations in the literature. So it's always good if you ever work with spherical coordinates to define your own set and be very communicative about it in the notes or papers you write. So that is the right-handed definition for me. And another thing that you might well use in later calculations is that the partial derivative with respect to, we'll just be living on the sphere, so the only important derivatives are with respect to the angles phi and theta. So the derivative with respect to these basis vectors, thank you, with respect to these basis vectors is e theta minus er 0. So where do I put the other one? Sorry that it gets a bit messier on this board. The other one is partial phi of er, e theta, e phi is sine theta e phi, cosine theta e phi, and minus sine theta ER minus cosine theta E theta. Okay? So this is just a service for you. You will need these identities as you move on. Okay. So now, in the 10 minutes left, let me get the spectrum, and maybe we'll care about the eigenstates later on. Let me get the spectrum for you. So is everyone finished with that slide, with that board? Because then I would erase that one. So now we have everything in play.
Better off raising the first one unless you need the top board.
Yeah.
Do you need the top board?
No.
You're better off then.
Okay, so what do we have now? We set up the lambda level problem for electrons on the sphere. This, by the way, we're starting now recalculating Haldane's paper from 83, which unfortunately is not so easy to calculate, to recalculate if you, you know. So a lot of intermediate steps are really glossed over. So what do we start with? We want to get the spectrum of this problem. So when Centil gave you the question of how to accomplish these statements about the monopole charge and related aspects, all these things can be answered just by looking at the spectrum. And in some ways, getting the spectrum is easier than the eigenstates. There's some tricks to get the spectrum without even caring about the eigenstates at all. In our case, later on, we want to care about these eigenstates. But for the moment, for example, if we have the coupling to the U1 gauge field, which we do have because we've just defined the coupling to the electromagnetic field is inherently part of the problem, we do not yet need to specify the particular gauge. I will only need to specify the gauge as soon as I'm talking about the actual eigenstates of the problem. So now, as we put this in spherical coordinates, this capital gamma kinematic angular momentum looks like this. From this expression, you can immediately see a couple of things. ER times gamma is gamma, ER is zero. And you can see what the commutation relations are of the individual Cartesian components. And this is a formula I want you to check until tomorrow. This is f from I j k lambda k minus s naught e r k lambda I e r j is I epsilon I j k e r k, where by e r k I mean the kth Cartesian component of ER. So what you will find, and that is the core thing to realize, okay, I make a big check here again, so let's recalculate this. But then what we find is that the true generator of rotations around the origin on the sphere, of course, has to be modified. I mean, you know the SO3, SO2 algebra. Only this guy should stand in there, not the additional term. So we need another angular momentum operator that relates to the generator of rotations on that sphere. And obviously, this has to take account the magnetic field. So it is natural to have the canonical angular momentum in the magnetic problem, because upon rotating your system, you need to consider the magnetic field as well. So quite naturally, we need the canonic angular momentum. But don't be fooled by mixing it up with the kinematic one. So the canonical angular momentum here is lambda plus S naught ER. And this is, and why am I saying this? This is the generator of rotations around the origin. And that is just another way of saying you take the Lie algebra, you get the generators, the exponential map of the generators will give you the finite transformation under the group operation. So in that case, I just write down the infinitesimal rotations, and we know how the infinitesimal rotations of a vector should look like, and you can just again check this, which is, it's sort of trivial, but check it anyway. Once you've checked this, this is trivial. Somebody's sleeping already, yeah. Xk, where x is whatever vector we have in the problem, could be capital gamma, could be epsilon r, could be L itself. Okay. Now, what's the next step? Once we realize what, yeah? Okay, so this is what I want you to check. You see that this is the commutator of the gamma operator. That's the kinematical angular momentum. The kinematic angular momentum doesn't share the SU2 algebra related to the rotations. Because if it were, there wouldn't be this additional term. Now, defining the angular momentum like this remedies this term, which is quite obvious to see. Okay? So this new operator is, by construction, set up in such a way that it relates to the generator of rotations around the origin of the sphere that we're setting up. And this is the definition of canonical angular momentum. And this is how this comes along. You should show a posteriori that setting this gives you this, and this is what you want, so this is right. Okay? And so what do we do when we have an angular momentum? Well, we can quantize it, so let's quantize it. So we quantize L. The first thing to realize, and that is important now, is that the projection of this canonical angular momentum along the radial direction is as naught. Notice that the kinematic angular momentum, capital gamma, was orthogonal to ER. So the ER, the radial projection of the kinematic angular momentum was zero, as it should be. Okay? Whereas the canonical angular momentum has an additional component along the radial direction. And this is exactly S naught. S naught